Yirmiyahu was a prophet, was a good chaver of mine. Never understood a single word he said, but we helped him to drink his yin. And we always have some mighty fine yin. Singing Simchat Le'olam, Kol Hayiladim now. Simchat to the dagim in the deep blue sea, Simchat to you and me.
Welcome to the Haftarah Plethora video podcast, where we've brought joy to the world almost 100 times over the past 3 years by talking about the prophets and the weekly Haftarah. This is our final episode, as we will discuss, and Rick will chant, the Haftarah for Simchat Torah, the only Haftarah in the Ashkenazi and Sephardi traditions that we've yet to cover. This will be the 85th separate Haftarah and the 99th recording since we've done 14 of them twice. Rick, what do you think about that?
I think that's amazing. I had no idea that we've done so many. And I can't believe that you've written almost 100 scripts. And that means on Sunday coming up, when we do this live at Simchat Torah services, that will be our 100th episode. How cool is that?
Very cool, Rick. And the number of trope drashes that you've come up with must number in the thousands. And every one of them has enhanced our understanding of the words of the prophets.
Thanks. And don't forget the contributions of our good friend Norm Gar, who encouraged us to improve the technical aspects of our recordings, added the beautiful introductory and concluding graphics, the on-screen text, the great music.
Rick, speaking of music, I don't think that I ever gave credit to Diane and my son Reuven for adapting the Three Dog Night song, Jeremiah Was a Bullfrog, for our introductory theme. But let's not spend any more time slapping ourselves on the back. Time to talk Haftarah for the final time. But first, I'm Larry Herman, sipping some very fine wine, sitting in my sukkah, and talking Haftarah with my very good chaver, the king of cantillation, Rick Muller. How are you doing today, Rick?
I'm a little sad at the thought that this is our final recorded episode. But speaking of your sukkah, I can see behind you, I was there with you and your family just the other day as we watched your grandson enter into the covenant. What a wonderful occasion that was.
Indeed it was, Rick. So before we get to Joshua, how about if we end our Haftarah Plethora series with the first It's Izzy Time segment?
And not Izzy and Millie time?
Millie's had plenty of on-screen time, and you'll see her as well here. Rick, you are right as usual. It was a wonderful occasion, as you can tell by the smiles on all the faces. Izzy was brought into the sukkah for his Brit Milah by his two grandmothers, Harriet and Diane. I had the honor of being the sandek and holding Izzy throughout the ceremony.
Honor and responsibility. The way you're looking at him shows how proud you are. Did you crack a joke there that had everyone laughing?
I don't recall, Rick, but I think that a brit is just such a joyous occasion that everyone is all smiles all the time.
Well, not everyone. Looks like Isaac knows what's coming.
Before he gets what's coming, he's wrapped in the talit of his namesake, my father, his great-grandfather, Irving, or Yitzchak.
Those are great speeches that Aaron and you gave, talking about your father and also Isaac's other grandfather, Roger, after whom he's also named.
Thank you, Rick. The Moyle, Dr. Andy Spall, my son Aaron, and Rabbi Rebecca Schatz all recited the various brachot.
With the aid of Millie.
And Aaron Beth's grandfather, Izzy's great-grandfather, Sonny, made the motzi over of Diane's beautiful homemade challah.
And I can attest as to how delicious it and the rest of the food was. Chazak ve'amatz to Isaac and to the entire family.
Thank you, Rick, both for the sentiment and for giving me the perfect segue into the Haftarah.
You liked how I did that, huh?
Yeah, I liked that you kept to the script, too. In any case, Chazak ve'amatz appears in the first chapter of Joshua the Haftarah for Simchat Torah 4 times. I think that you could say that it's the theme of the Haftarah.
Yep, and I have a lot to say about the tropes on those occasions.
Great, but allow me to first give a general overview of the Haftarah. This introduction to the book of Joshua is a transition, or actually a set of transitions, from the backward-looking book of Deuteronomy to the forward-looking first book of the prophets, from the leadership of Moses representing the old guard to the leadership of Joshua representing the generations of fighting leaders, and from the years of wanderings to the rapid conquest and occupation of the promised land. The Haftarah is neatly divided into 2 parts. In the first 9 verses, we have God speaking to Joshua, giving him his assignment, charge, and responsibilities, and thrice encouraging him with the words, Chazak ve'amatz.
Can I add what I want to say about those 2 words now?
Not yet, Rick. The second half of the chapter is Joshua speaking to the officials of the people, and then to the leaders of the tribes of Reuven, Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh. You'll recall that those are the tribes who chose to settle on the eastern side of the Jordan, but promised Moses that they would fight in the vanguard to conquer the land. Joshua is reminding them of their pledge. The chapter and Haftarah end with those same leaders confirming their unswerving loyalty, and finally using the same words as Moses and God, exhorting Joshua, Chazak ve'amatz.
Right. Now can I talk about those words in the trope?
Yes, Rick. Now we can talk more about Chazak ve'amatz.
That time. The phrase Chazak ve'amatz is actually used 6 times in the Tanakh, twice in the Torah, in Parsha Vayelech, and then the 4 times that we find it here in our Haftorah. In the first occasion in the Torah, Deuteronomy 31:7, Moses exhorts Joshua in front of all of Israel, Chazak ve'ematz. In the second occasion, verse 23, same chapter, God charges Joshua with the very same words that Moses used, using the same trope, a munach followed by a sigol, Chazak ve'ematz. The sigol is one of the rarest trope we know, suggesting the importance of the phrase. Then in the first occasion in our Haftorah, in verse 6, God is again speaking directly to Joshua and tells him, Chazak ve'ematz.
Pretty pedestrian trope here, only a tibcha and an etnachta.
True, but then in the next verse, verse 7, God repeats the phrase with more intense trope for emphasis. Rak. Chazak ve'ematz me'od. Notice that not only does God add the words rock in front of it and me'od after it, only and very, but the tropes on Chazak ve'ematz are your favorites, the dramatic kadma v'yazla. And then in verse 9, where God concludes his charge to Joshua, he tells him, Halo tziviticha. Chazak ve'ematz.
Have I not charged you, be strong and stalwart, to use Robert Alter's translation? And I note that the trope on the Chazak ve'ematz are a munach followed by a zakef katon, which you theorized signals a particularly important phrase.
Thanks for remembering that. But this time, it's following a mapach pashta, which isn't exactly part of my theory. Nonetheless, I agree that the phrase, Halo tziviticha, haven't I charged you, does give it an extra bit of zest. Finally, the final time Chazak ve'ematz is used in the Tanakh are the final words of the final verse of this chapter and Haftorah, when the leaders of the 2.5 tribes encourage Joshua, Rak Chazak ve'ematz.
So the addition of the word rak, only, and the fact that you chant it with the sof haftarah trope underscore the importance of the phrase.
Exactly. And I think that one reason why the Masoretes use different trope on the different forms of chazak ve'ematz is to reach more people. Different people learn in different ways, so the different trope are an attempt to get the message across to different groups.
And speaking of differences, we've now talked a lot about the use of chazak ve'ematz, the trope in the various contexts, but we haven't discussed the meanings and translations.
Well, you gave one translation from Alter, be strong and stalwart. But I think that the most common translation is be strong and courageous.
That's true. But Rick, I checked a variety of translations and I came up with 10 different translations. Everett Fox uses be strong and courageous, as you suggested. The JPS says be strong and resolute. The Koran Chumash says be strong and of good courage. The Rashi Chumash has be strong and firm. Alter, as we've heard, has be strong and stalwart. The Kahani Chumash has be courageous and brave. And Mitsuda has be courageous and bold. And our old friend Aryeh Kaplan actually has three slightly different translations. Be strong and brave, be strong and of good courage, be strong and very courageous.
Again, the slight variations may speak to different people, but those are all pretty close.
I agree, but I have my own idea of what it means, at least in a modern context.
Why am I not surprised?
Because I wouldn't be me if I didn't buck the crowd, at least a little bit. Rick, we cannot help but associate Chazak ve'ematz with Joshua, since it's only directed toward him. But why two words and not just one? Clearly, the first term, chazak, refers to capability, strength in the physical sense, and also in the intellectual and spiritual sense, wisdom, judgment, sensitivity, leadership. But possessing those traits alone is not enough. Joshua is also exhorted to ve'ematz, to be brave, to be courageous, stalwart, or bold. In other words, to persevere. A successful leader such as Joshua must have both capabilities and perseverance. And I think we have a modern word for this. It's called grit. The Oxford Dictionary defines grit as courage and resolve, strength of character.
So God is telling Joshua to have grit?
I think so.
I like that. How about if I use my capabilities to chant the Haftarah now?
Rick, you've also got grit, so go for it. As I mentioned, we'll split the chanting into two parts. Verses 1 through 9 is God's charge to Joshua. Then verses 10 through 18 has Joshua speaking to the people through their officials, and then to the 2.5 tribes. Rick, any final trope notes on the first part?
Just a couple. You mentioned the transition from the end of the Torah. The Haftarah starts with, Vayehi acharei mot Moshe. And it happened after the death of Moses. Both of the Revi'ah and the Tavir go down. The music goes down, suggesting a sadness. The death of Moses, very sad. But then in verse 2, we have Ve'ata kum avor. And now arise and cross the Jordan, the Kadmavi Azla, lifting up our spirits.
Rick, I notice in verse 2, we have two hazes, and then another in verse 4, a total of 7 in the Haftarah. You often talk about the importance of the word zeh. Robert Alter agrees with you and notes the importance of this Jordan, this people, and this Lebanon, all of which he calls positional.
Whatever that means. But who am I to question Robert Alter, especially when he agrees with me? Let me jump to verse 8, where we have a pazer, the rarest of the Haftorah trope, in an intense phrase that includes a Tilisha Ketana and Kadmavi Azla combo. Lo yamush sefer atorah hazeh mipicha. Now, the Etz Chaim Chumash translates that as, let not this book of the teaching cease from your lips, which rearranges the word order, but the message is clear. Joshua must speak the words of Torah that were transmitted to him from Moses. This fits right into the transitions that you talked about.
And we've got yet another hazeh emphasizing this book of teaching. Rick, Let not the chanting cease from your lips. Time for the bracha, and then verses 1 through 9. The text of the Haftarah can be found on page 1267 of the Eitz Chaim Chumash, and on your screen, beautifully illustrated, thanks to Norm Gar.
Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kichanu b'mitzvotav, v'tzivanu la'asok b'divrei Torah.
Amen.
Vayehi acharei mot Moshe Eved Adonai, Vayomer Adonai, El Yehoshua Binun, Misharet Moshe Lemor, Moshe Avdi Met, Veata Kum Avor, Et Hayarden Haze, Ata. V'chol ha'am hazeh el ha'aretz asher anochi noten lahem livnei Yisrael kol makom asher tiroch kaf raglechem bo lachem netativ Kasher dibarti el Moshe Mehamidbar Vehalbanon hazeh Ve'ad hanahar Agadol nahar parat Kol eretz hachitim Ve'ad hayam agadol Mevo hashamesh Yieh gvulchem, lo yitzev ish lefanecha, kol yemecha yecha, kasher hayiti im Moshe, eyeh imach, lo arpecha, velo ezvecha, chazak ve'ematz, Ki ata tanchil et ha'am hazeh, et ha'aretz, asher nishbati lavotam latet lahem. Rak chazak ve'ematz me'od, lishmor lasot kechol ha'torah. Asher tzivcha Moshe avdi, al tasur mimenu yamin usmol, lema'an taskil bechol asher telech, lo yamush sefer ha'torah hazeh mipicha. V'hagita bo yomam v'layla lema'an tishmor la'asot kechol ha'katuv bo ki az tatzliach et drachecha v'az taskil halo tziviticha Chazak ve'ematz al ta'arotz ve'al techat ki imcha Adonai Elohecha bechol asher telech.
Beautiful. Rick, what trope treasures do you have to share with us in the second part of the Haftarah?
Trope treasures, huh? Okay, let's start with verse 14. Which has a couple of interesting trope teasers. We start with the beginning of the verse. Nishechem tapchem umiknechem yeshvu ba'aretz. Let your wives, children, and livestock remain in the land that Moses assigned to you on this side of the Jordan. So we've got a rare munach Zarkah Sigol combo on the first words, suggesting that these were the most precious things that the men of the 2.5 tribes possessed. But then we've got a very rare double Zakef Gadol on Yeshvu and Ba'aretz. They shall dwell in this land.
I suppose that the trope are allowing Joshua to reaffirm the agreement that Moses made with them.
Yeah, but then there's the other side of the bargain. Ve'atem tavru chamushim lifnei achechem.
And you will cross over armed in front of your brothers. The Kadmah V'Azla, drawing attention to the phrase that Robert Alter translates as arrayed for combat.
Yeah, putting themselves at risk. I got one more for you. In verse 16, we start the verse with a zakef katon on the word vayaanu. And they answered, these are the leaders of the 2.5 tribes. But it's very rare for a verse to start with a naked zakef katon all by itself. It's kind of jarring to the musical flow.
Rick, I have an idea. Perhaps it's meant to infer that their answer to Joshua's reminder of their commitment was instantaneous, without any hesitation.
That makes perfect sense, especially as they continue with Kol Asher Tzivitanu Na'aseh, all that you charged us, we will do.
And how about if we charge you with finishing the Haftarah verses 10 through 18?
All that you charged me, I will do.
Vayitzav Yoshua et shotrei ha'am lemor ivru bekerev hamachane vitzavu et ha'am lemor hachinu lachem tzeda ki ve'od shloshet yamim Atem ovrim et hayarden hazeh lavo lareshet et haaretz asher Adonai Elohechem noten lachem lerishtah vela ruveni vela gadi vela chatzi shevet hamanasheh Amar Yehoshua lemor, Zachor et hadavar, Asher tziva erchem, Moshe evad Adonai lemor, Adonai Elohechem, Meniach lachem, Venatan lachem, et haaretz hazot, Neshechem, Tapchem umiknechem yeshvu ba'aretz asher natan lachem Moshe be'ever hayarden ve'atem ta'avru chamushim lifnei achechem kol Giborei hachayil, va'azartem otam, ad asher yaniach Adonai lachechem, kachem v'yorshu gam heima et haaretz asher Adonai Elohechem noten lahem. V'shavtem le'eretz Yerushalchem v'rishtem otach asher natan lachem Moshe ever Adonai be'ever hayarden mizrach hashamesh v'ya'anu et Yehoshua le'mor Kol asher tzivitanu na'aseh, ve'el kol asher tishlachenu nelech. Kechol asher shamanu el Moshe, kein nishma elecha, rak yiyeh Adonai Elohecha imach kasher haya im Moshe. Kol ish asher yamre et picha velo yishma et dvarecha lechol asher titzavenu yumat rak chazak ve'ematz.
Chazak ve'ematz. What a way to finish up our final episode. Rick, it's been fun and a fantastic learning opportunity for me. As always, and with great sincerity, thanks to Norm Gar for everything he's done on this and all the other episodes, the beautiful graphics, text, and music.
And for reminding me to keep my head up, literally.
Thanks to our loyal viewers for watching.
And even to our occasional viewers.
And even though it's our last show, please write to us with your thoughts and comments. Our emails are below. And if you like our Zoomcast, please forward the link to your friends and family. Rick and I look forward to the live version on Simchat Torah, followed by Rick's chanting of the Haftarah from Joshua. We hope to see you there.
And you can also catch the episode for Shmini Atzeret, which is linked in the notes.
Shabbat Shalom and Chag Sameach.
Chag Sameach, and keep on troping.